by the Dummerston Conservation Commission, and we often do them together with the Bonneville Environmental Education Center. But we really want people from the greater community to come. Our goal is to really educate people about our natural environment, and there's no town line when it comes to any of that. So we're grateful to the community center, Jean Momini, for making this available to us. So without further ado, let me introduce Chris Petrak.
Thank you. The program tonight will be in two parts. The first part is going to be experiential, and the second part will be, I guess you'd say, didactic. Hopefully we'll learn something. But this is the beginning of the hawk watch season. Although the hawks are so far flying very slowly and few in number, hopefully that'll pick up soon, comes off of last year, which was an absolutely stunning record year. I'm going to begin with a program that has no narration. It's strictly visual. There are captions on the photographs which identify the hawks that are presented here. This is mostly from last year on Putney Mountain, and it will hopefully give you some kind of a feeling or sense of what that experience of watching hawks on Putney Mountain can be like.
Things that you can't even see. Fly away.
This program I put together first for the school that my children, my grandchildren attend in Philadelphia, the Frankfurt Friends School. And it was suggested that I do something on hawks. Quakers are very pacifists, and the school certainly embodies that ethic. But the children themselves can be bloody little devils at times, fascinated by the kinds of things that hawks do. I need to first of all just introduce you to my grandchildren, because they're going to figure in this a little bit later on. This is Celia. She's 10. She's a slip of a little girl. And she is the titmouse that will appear later on. This is Oliver. He's 7. He's in kindergarten. He's going to be the goldfinch later on. And you should know that when I did the program for the school, he had a broken foot, so he was in a cast. Keep that in mind. And we have Julius, who is 13. He's going to be the Blue Jay when we get further along in the program. So we are dealing with hawks, which are birds of prey. Most people look up in the sky and they see big black birds circling and they kind of wonder what they are. And I have had people call me and tell me they have seen 5 eagles circling over the Putney Meadow or the Brattleboro Meadows. Well, they're probably seeing turkey vultures, which are big black soaring birds. They soar with this dihedral V shape to the wings. They are magnificent flyers, but they are not hawks. They are basically carrion eaters. They've got a face that only a mother turkey vulture could love. Sometimes becoming a little more likely is the possibility of having black vultures. They're being reported just about every spring and fall, probably not nesting in Vermont yet, but certainly in the area. They're a big black bird. They've got no head and a tail that looks like it's been clipped off with a pair of shears. And instead of having white all along the backs of the wings, as does the turkey vulture, they have white at the tip. There. Now I've got my point working anyway. Common ravens, and we see that a lot along Route 30. They're nesting in the old quarry in Dummerston, and they'll stay around all year. They love riding the currents, and on Putney Mountain, we love watching them, but they're not hawks. And another rather large black bird is the crow. Easily distinguished in flight from the raven because it goes as the crow flies, flaps in a straight line. This guy is apparently carrying a, looks like a frog back, probably to young in the nest. The hawks that we are most likely to see, most people are most likely to see, is soaring overhead, are the red tails. And here's a red tail up very high, sort of light underneath, sometimes with a red tail that is quite evident. And I say sometimes because the young birds do not have red tails, and even this adult from underneath, the tail looks quite white as it is soaring. Here is a red tail also out hunting. In addition to the red tail is not a dependable marker. A belly band and a leading edge here, if you're close enough on the ground to see those sorts of things or have good binoculars, are better marks for the red tail that is in flight. And this is the bird that you are most likely to see along the highways, especially in the wintertime. There have been some stretches of the interstates where I will see them every 2 or 3 miles perched on the top of a tree. And the interstates have been a real boon to
the red tails, because they provide an open area where they can hunt throughout the year. They don't have to go as far south as many of the other hawks do. Eagles are a big dark bird that may be seen, you know, the first 20, 25 years when I was bird watching, I could count on my 10 fingers the number of times that I've seen eagles, that I saw eagles. Now it is almost to the point where if I want to see an eagle, I can go see an eagle on that day. You might have to go someplace where you know they're hanging out, but they've become very common. And I think I photographed this one over Sunset Lake a year or two ago. And here is a first-year eagle. They don't become mature until about the fifth year. The plumage changes that they go through enable us to identify how old they are. This is a first-year bird. So just hatched and raised this year. And they become very common nesters. Now, we have a nest down in Hinsdale. There's another one up in just north of Bellows Falls. Townsend Dam area, there is an eagle nesting. There is apparently some indication that there is a nesting pair on Somerset Reservoir, which I've suspected for 10 years. This nest actually is within the city limits of Philadelphia.
Wow.
At Hines National Wildlife Refuge. Now, this was taken with a telephoto lens, obviously, but immediately behind where I was standing, not more than a few hundred feet, was an Amtrak line. Beyond that Amtrak line was I-95, and beyond that was the Philadelphia International Airport, where the planes were taking off all through the day. So these have become birds that have become very adaptable and are filling niches which have been empty for a long time. In fact, they're filling niches because they have become so abundant, relatively speaking, that they're looking for the nesting locations. I think this also was a bird that I photographed on Sunset Lake. So those are some of the birds that we are probably most likely to see. Now, if I ask most people, what do robins eat? What do you think they would answer?
Worms.
Worms, right. And grubs and insects and all kinds of things like that. And they eat worms in the spring and summertime because they're protein and they've got to feed their young. But most of the year, robins are vegetarians. They eat berries. They don't eat seeds, but they eat fruit. I think they may like the fruit because at, you know, halfway through the winter it's become fermented. And just in case you think this is an anomaly, here is a very young robin that I photographed just a week ago with, I think, a grape or some kind of berry at any rate. So even as the young bird, it has learned. Now, that's very different from the birds of prey. The birds of prey all in some way eat living protein. Mice, and by the way, most of these next few pictures I took in my backyard last year when there was just a profusion of rodents. So we have mice. We have wood rats. We have chipmunks. These things were, all of these were all over the place last year. Red squirrels, these are all well within the ability of most hawks, and sometimes they can take bigger things. Pigeons. Cities and towns have tried to control pigeon populations for years. When they get nesting hawks within the city, that is probably the best pigeon control there is. And, you know, pigeons can nest, they only raise two, but they do it over and over and over through the summertime. That then becomes, a larder for the birds of prey that may winter in a town or city. Mourning doves are a favorite food, as are many other kinds of birds. But mourning dove is one of the two birds that I find evidence most often in my backyard that there has been a hawk through. Here is the remains of a mourning dove. Here's its head. More often, I'll just find tufts of feathers, but this winter, and the only thing that would be taking that would be a hawk. So I'll get my sermon out of the way real quickly. If you have feeders outside, expect hawks, and don't try to prevent them taking your birds. They're all trying to make a living. It's a tough world out there. And if you're going to feed songbirds, you're going to be feeding hawks as well. Blue jays are favorite birds for the bird hunting hawks. And I remember one springtime, pre-Irene, when I came out to the white pine grove that was along the bank of my river, and the snow had melted, and here were all of these blue jay feathers just scattered all over. Some hawk had been taking the blue jays and then just feeding on them in the pine trees through the wintertime. Toads, frogs, snakes, all kinds of amphibians are food for hawks. Dragonflies and other large insects. There are many of our hawks that make their living with things like this. I can remember being down in Cape May one time in the springtime, and there were several Mississippi kites flying around, and they were just feeding on the dragonflies that had hatched out. I can remember one time on Putney Mountain, we watched a kestrel grab a dragonfly out of midair and feed on the wing as it continued flying. Never missed the beat, as I recall. So let's talk about some different methods of hunting. This is a red-tailed hawk, and they often do a perch and plunge kind of hunting. It's what I call the teenage boys' method of hunting. Now, I came up with this one day this last winter when we were visiting with our grandchildren in Philadelphia, and we hadn't seen Julius, the teenager, at all, until the cookies came out of the oven. All of a sudden, he came into the kitchen, grabbed a handful of cookies, said, "Hi, Granddad," and left. That's what the red-tailed hawk does. It sits on a perch, watches for prey, and when it sees it, it goes and gets it, hopefully. This is a fairly young bird, so hopefully it is successful. The other thing that a red-tailed hawk will do is a variation of the same theme. It will just hover in one place, kiting. And we often see red-tailed hawks on Putney Mountain doing that. They'll just hover absolutely still until they spot something on the ground. And here is one that we watched, and down it went. And a short time later, it came up with something in its talons. Now, unfortunately, the picture was far enough away that I could never quite get the resolution to know what it was. I think it was probably a wood rat that it had. And there, hovering over our heads, it had lunch. Ate on the wing. The Budios in general practice that kind of teenage foraging method. This is a broad-winged hawk up in Somerset a couple of springs ago. It will also do the circling and hunting, and when it spots something, it will go down and try to grab it. And the birds have an ability in their eyesight to pick up the traces of animals moving through a mat of grass so that they know where the prey is and where to strike. Here is a broadwing hawk nest, which was along Tinson Hill Road a few years ago. And the adult is in the center, and two of the kids are fighting over some food here, pulling it apart. So they're just like all kids. A red-shouldered hawk is the third buteo that is in our woods, although this is a very young hawk, but it also will practice that wait and plunge kind of hunting. The broad wings and the red shoulders like amphibians and snakes and toads. But while the different hawk species may have preferred specialties in their prey, when researchers go to their nests and examine the remains, they find that basically they take advantage of whatever is available. If food is put in front of them, they'll grab it. And here is a red tail in flight, showing remarkably clearly the sort of windows that hawk watch at the ends of the wings that hawk watchers look for in order to identify the red shoulders. Red shoulders used to be the most common buteo in New England. As the forests have matured and the red tails have been able to prosper, the red shoulders have declined considerably. So that's sort of the wait and look kind of hunting. The falcons have a completely different technique. They have long pointed wings and they hunt with speed. This is a peregrine falcon. This is one of two pictures of peregrine falcons that I'm willing to show in public. I just haven't been able to get very many good photos of that. And John will tell me that it's because I wasn't on Putney Mountain the right day last year when a whole slew of them came through in the late afternoon. But that's what happens, you know, if you're going to get those things, you've got to put in the time as well. Here's the other one. Long pointed wings. Peregrine falcons, when they stoop or dive, can reach speeds up to 200 miles an hour. And they have been known as the duck hawk. They will hit a hawk or a duck or their prey and stun it and then come back and finish it off. A bird that has become much more common at the hawk watch is the merlin. And this is a bird that has kind of defied the general trend of range expansion. This is a northern bird that has been expanding its range southward and is now nesting in Vermont, where a few years ago it was not. But this is a young bird. This is a bird that relies on its speed. On Putney Mountain, we will sometimes have something that will come and be there and be gone in about that much time, and somebody will say, what was that? Well, that was a merlin. It just goes like the dickens. Now, here's one. This youngster is going into a stoop, not for food, but for the decoy owl that we have up there. And here we can get a look at one on the ground, also a young bird. This was along the shore in Cape May County, New Jersey. These very often winter along the shores where there are shorebirds, and they look on the shorebird populations in the wintertime as their grocery larder. The kestrel is the third of our falcons. This is sort of an elfin-type bird. In a heavy wind, it'll be bounced around. In fact, even in a light wind, it'll be bounced around. Doesn't have much body to it. But long wings, And once again, it's a bird that depends on speed to make its capture. This one might be looking for food, might be looking for a dragonfly in the air, or might be wondering about those strange people down there looking at him. Yeah. Here is a pair. The male and female, and I watched this pair as the male would fly down to the ground, and it flew down to the ground, got a mouse, brought it back up to the mate. So it was in courtship, and it was demonstrating that it could be a good provider for her and her young. Fairly common kind of courtship behavior among the birds. We've got to get a close-up look. This is, it's not only our smallest hawk and falcon, it's also the most beautiful. He is just gorgeous, just gorgeous. And the neat thing is that there's enough difference between the men and the women that we can pick them out in flight. Here is a female. And I watched her hunting over the marsh out in Massachusetts. So, sit and wait, speed, run them down. This is a harrier. This is the bird that over grasslands or marshes, you'll see just kind of floating up and down and up and down, and you can see that it's looking down, and it'll hover for a moment, and then it'll continue on. But that's not the, you know, sight is not the only technique it has for finding prey. Does this picture suggest anything to anybody?
An owl,
that's right. And this one might show it even better. It has a disc, a feather disc on its face, much like owls, so that it uses both sight and hearing to find its prey and go down for it. And here, and the harrier, by the way, is from a distance is easily identifiable, if in no other way, by the white rump, which it has in all ages and plumages.
Can you see that from below?
What's that?
Can you see that from below?
Not from below. You've got to sort of get a top view of it, or on an angle, but it's a pretty clear white rump. So it hunts by sight and sound. While owls are mostly nocturnal, and our hawks are mostly daylight hunting, here is a bird that has taken the owl feature of hunting by sound and applies it to its lifestyle. And here is a young harrier going down into the marsh grasses after prey. And the birds, if they're not nesting, when they catch the prey, they'll stay right there and eat it. So the osprey does sort of a, well, it's a fish hawk. It's a fish hawk. All of its diet is fish, which, you know, it flies overhead, hovers until it sees something, looks for the fish down below the surface of the water, and when it spots it, then dives. And it will go completely into the water, come up, shake itself off, and take flight. Hopefully with a fish small enough that it can carry. Now I have yet to get one actually coming out. I've seen some pictures. I've yet to get one actually coming out with a fish. But I'm hoping for that. This one had just dove, came up empty, which is not unusual. Not every hunting foray by any of the hawks is successful. Once it gets out, if it's got to take that fish somewhere to eat it or to feed young, it turns it around so that the fish's head is facing forward. Aerodynamic, right? It makes sense. It could carry it easier. So here is an osprey very early in the season, before it has started to nest. It's caught a fish. It's just gone up to a perch, and it's eating it. I got a little bit too close to it for its comfort, so it took its fish. Still not quite as aerodynamic, because the head's gone, but in the same way, and flew off with it. These are birds that generally mate for life, although he and she take completely separate vacations during the winter time. They come back together if they made it through the year, add on to their nest and add on to their nest. This is a net, and this is a bird that is global, found on every continent. This was a nest I photographed in the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone, and it has been used over and over for many years, as the sheer size and bulk suggests. They like the tops of trees. They like the tops of transmission towers, radio towers, nesting platforms in the middle of marshes. It provides protection from predators. And yes, hawks, though they are very effective predators, can be preyed upon, especially the young, by raccoons and snakes and ravens and bigger hawks. So the osprey deals with that by putting its nest up high and making it very difficult for a predator to get there, and with one parent staying with the young. And there are three chicks here. This one looks like he can barely hold his head up.
I know.
And this is a nest that I've been following in Forsyth Refuge, used to be known as Brigantine, near Atlantic City for a number of years. 30 years ago, it was hard to find an osprey. They were severely affected by DDT. Now it's almost ho-hum, except for the fact that they are so big and magnificent that you can never just say ho-hum about them. And here it is, feeding the chick. So the accipiters have a completely different environment that they prefer and way of hunting. This is a young sharpshin hawk, and these are birds that are adapted to forest and open woodlands. The sharp-shinned hawk has relatively short, rather round wings and a long tail, and this enables it to maneuver through and among trees. And I one time watched one literally just make a U-turn in the middle of a lilac bush. So they're very agile, and their preferred food is birds. Here's another sharpie. As I say, very much of a woodlands bird. A second accipiter is the Cooper's hawk. Very similar, bulkier. You would call, you know, the sharp shin might be the wide receiver, the Cooper's hawk is the tight end or the lineman. Big head, but the round wings, the long tail. Cooper's hawks have made a real recovery in recent years. Hawk Rock sites used to see an average, at least down in Cape May, they used to see an average of about 20 sharp shins and one Cooper's. Now it's about 3 sharp shins and one Cooper's. This is the sharp shin being banded in Cape May and taken out for educational purposes. It's a small bird. This is a 4-ounce bird. This is a bird about the size of a blue jay or a robin, so not very big. And it will tend to prefer the smaller birds. By contrast, this is a Cooper's hawk. And it's quite capable of going after the larger birds. And I once saw a Cooper's hawk on the ice in the retreat meadows on top of a dead pigeon. It had just killed the pigeon. Before it got a chance to eat the pigeon, a red tail came down, chased off the Cooper's hawk, and then flew off with the pigeon. So then the Cooper's had to hunt again. This is a young Cooper's hawk, and from this swelling in the down here, that seems to indicate a full crop or a partially full crop, so it has just eaten recently. And here's a comparison of the tails, but for both of them, long, narrow, also a good comparison of the size. I think this was a female, and no, I'm sorry, I was going to say this was a female. I'm not sure. I do know that when I saw these, I was taken by how much of a size difference there was. So, I have a Cooper's hawk, and around our bird feeders, it used to be that the most likely hawk would be the sharpshoot. Cooper's have made such a comeback that the more likely bird now is the Cooper's. So I'm a young Cooper's hawk. Celia the titmouse, a little slip of a thing, is at the feeder. And I'm hungry. But also in the same area is Julius the blue jay. Now, who am I going to go after?
Bigger the better.
You got it. I'm going to spend the same amount of energy going after either one of those birds, and the blue jay will give me a much bigger payoff. So I'm going to go after the blue jay. Now, to Celia's relief, on this particular occasion, Julia started making a lot of squawking noises, warned all the birds, they flew off, and everybody was safe. Okay, so the blue jays are really sentinels around your feeders. Mm-hmm. Don't think they're bullies, and don't complain because they're noisy. They're doing an important service for all of those birds, as well as themselves. So now we've got a flock of goldfinch. And at this point, I had Oliver's kindergarten class stand up. And I asked the question, okay, I'm a hungry Cooper's hawk. Which one am I going to go after? Anybody?
The wounded one?
You're right. I'm going to go after Oliver because he's slightly lame. He didn't think he was. And I watched him run around, but he wasn't quite as fast as it couldn't be quite as fast. So these birds are able to almost instantaneously determine who is at a slight disadvantage. And that, if they're effective hunters, that's who they're going to go after. However, Julius was still around. He raised the alarm, and once again, the birds got away. And once again, I was still hungry. This is a Cooper's hawk I photographed it just a few weeks ago on Black Mountain Road. Young one. It was in the middle of the road, and it flew up here. I hope it knew what it was doing. Because if it doesn't learn how to hunt, it's not going to make it. And that was the problem I had when Julius raised the alarm and chased everybody off, and I went hungry. I can't do that, have that happen all the time, or I won't make it. So Putney Mountain, as the first part suggested, is a good place for good camaraderie, beautiful scenery. But don't expect to walk up there and save 150 birds in the half hour that you've pried out of the day. You might, but it's also quite likely that you won't see anything. And the hawk watchers do spend a lot of time looking for birds, waiting for the conditions to be just right, seeing this profile in the sky and calling it a Cooper's hawk. And after a time, experienced hawk watchers can pick out that profile at a long distance and identify it. The ospreys always bring a feeling of the light. They are just big, magnificent birds, and oftentimes can be identified from when they're just a speck in the distance because of what I call the McDonald's shape of their wings. They fly when they're cruising with a big M shape to their wings. We get a lot of school groups that come up, and they can be great fun. And we're always, oh, look at that. We've got something else with wings.
Wow.
And what we really like to see, and this is the time of the year to see it, are the kettles of broadwings. I think I counted 45 to 50 wow. broadwings. And that's a fairly sizable kettle. But we've had groups of broadwings in the 100, 200, 300. And then it becomes really a challenge, a fun challenge to count them. This is what the broadwing looks like. This is the bird that is heading to Central and South America, often on a journey through the fall, winter, and spring that might accumulate to 9 or 10,000 miles of traveling. They're the bird that comes over in the biggest numbers, usually between the 10th and 20th of September. This is the same bird from the same photograph. This is for anybody who's interested. How do you get a close-up picture? We get one like this and you crop it. All right. Here is a northern harrier. That white rump is a clear giveaway. There are other clues because sometimes at a distance we can't always see the white rump. A red-tailed hawk, and a red-tailed hawk that's eaten very recently. Look at the size of its crop. So that's a good sign. And sometimes they're close enough that we can get some really clear looks at it. We don't always see that brilliant red tail, but this gentleman was quite low. Bald eagles. What was our bald eagle count last year, John?
Around 100.
100. Yeah.
Nice. Nice.
And 15 years ago, we'd be happy with 30 or 40. In a year. So there have been tremendous increase in the eagles, and they are magnificent. And the heaviest of winds, those guys would just be moving along without a care in the world. You can handle. And that last picture in this one I took yesterday. So we didn't have a lot of birds, but when an eagle comes over at that kind of a height, it is thrilling, yes. This looks like it might be a not quite full adult eagle. Still some white under the wings and head not quite white. As I said, it takes them 5 years to reach full maturity. I think this is a goshawk. John? I think.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I don't get to see quite enough of it. No, this was a goshawk. And there are birds, many of the goshawks stay for the winter, feeding on grouse and snowshoe hares. Now, in the early morning and through mid-morning, we'll often get huge flights of blue jays, and that's what these are. They'll come up on one side, pause in the trees, and then fly down, never without a lot of conversation. So we count them as well. Here is a broad-winged hawk that flew over, and as he's flying over, he pulls his legs forward. And let's go. Well, poop on you guys. attracts a lot of the young, naive birds who, well, I'm not quite sure what they're doing, but I also saw on top of the parking garage in Brattleboro, there is a building nearby that has one of these plastic owls on top of it. The pigeons were all around. So it doesn't deter birds, but it sure does excite some of the young sharpshins and coopers and Merlin. That was a Merlin on the other one. This is a Cooper's hawk that was going after. One of the fun things is when we get a couple of birds that mix it up, and I think we had a, I think the one on the right is a Merlin, and I can't remember what the other one is. Sometimes I have to make notes of this as soon as I get home to remember that. Here is a goshawk that was mixing it up with a raven. And you can see that the raven is a big bird. It's as big or bigger than a red tail. Here is a Cooper's hawk on the right going after a northern heron. And both of them were young birds. The Cooper's hawk and the sharpshins just have an attitude. This is the same two birds. And they're constantly mixing up with one another and going after anybody. So one of the ways that we learn about hawks and their travels is by banding them. And last November, I spent a day down in Cape May with Eric Slayton. Does anybody know Eric? Eric used to live in the area, real fine naturalist. And he spends a week down there banding hawks. This is the shelter, and this is all part of the research project of the Cape May Bird Observatory. So you sit in this thing, and there are lines going out to spring nets, and you wait for the birds to come in. And you attract the birds with one of three different smaller birds. One is a pigeon. The other that is permitted is a starling. Wow. And they have this little leather harness, and they're attached to this wire. And the third is a house sparrow. Now, those three birds are allowed because they are exotics, and they tend to displace native species. They don't really belong in North America. Now, I have never seen one of these birds injured, which says that the banders are also very careful. But they are in this harness and with a string so that they can be agitated, and that gets the hawk interested, and they come in, and then they are caught in this spring net. And this is Eric here and a friend of his that was with him for a couple of days. We are here taking a young Cooper's hawk out of the net. And here is the Cooper's hawk after it has been processed and banded with a unique band. And if it's ever caught or found and the person knows what to do, they can report that number. And that helps to trace the travels, to trace the age, to continue to monitor its health. So now Eric is getting a red tail out of the net. And they're not particularly happy about it, but it doesn't hurt them in the least. And that's a spring trap, which we'll look at it again in a minute.
Wow.
Yeah, they're feisty. They're feisty.
Cut this up.
Yeah. So then he takes it inside the blind, and down here you see that there is a ruler on the bench, and he measures the wing length, and there are different size cans of coffee cans put together like that, and he picks the right size, slips the bird in head first, doesn't do anything, doesn't hurt the bird at all, but it also calms it, and then He knows the weight of the can. He weighs it. So then he can get a weight on the bird. He examines the bird to see what its fat reserves are like, determine whether it has eaten recently by feeling the crop, generally look at the health of the bird. Then picks the right size band, and this little instrument over here is a gauge which indicates what size this bird needs, and then that is little band is slipped over the leg and pinched together with the pliers.
Can you tell the age on those birds? How old are
they? This was a first year bird. Most of the hawks can be aged as hatch year, sometimes after hatch year, and adult. Sometimes there is a transition between the, particularly with things like Hoopers and Sharpshin, there's a transition between the hatch year plumage and the adult plumage. And if it's in between, then it's a second year bird.
How long do they live?
That varies according to species. The smaller the species, the shorter the lifespan. Red tails, which are large birds, can live 15, 20 years. Eagles can go 30, 35 years.
Wow.
If they stay healthy and lucky. Now, behind me over here is the other type. This is not quite a mist net. Mist nets are very fine mesh nets that are used for songbirds. This is a little bigger net, but this would be used, this would capture things like sharpshins, kestrels, some of the smaller hawks. They would fly into that, get caught, and then be untangled. And, you know, they are so very careful about not damaging feathers. So here is a young red tail that has come in on the pigeon. And he was slightly away from the spring trap, which is sort of a hoop, circle. So Eric was able to pull on the strings and get the pigeon and move the pigeon and the bird over in the center of the net. Mm-hmm. And the bird, for a brief instant, thought, I've got it. And then he springs the trap and catches the bird. And it all of a sudden says, hey, this isn't what I had in mind. So here the bird has been processed. Now, Eric does something very interesting. He figures these birds, especially the young birds, they were expecting to eat. So he gives it a mouse. See the tail hanging out? So this guy didn't go away completely hungry. He had a bunch of dead baby mice that he had on hand, and he would feed them to the hawk after he had processed everything and before he let it go. So this guy is all done. I want to go back here. Okay, so here is... here we've got a hawk ready to leave now and to be released. And we take a few minutes and get some pictures of it. The next few pictures were taken in about 1.5 seconds, which is what the cameras can do. We're going to take a lot longer to look at them. But so anyway, he's got the hawk. It's all been processed. And now... releases. And I'm flying free once again. Yes. So there we are. Thank you very much.
Do people
Yes.
Most of the photos that you did take were from the Putney Mountain Group.
Yes, site. Most of them were. The last series were in Cape May. Yeah, right. But most of them were.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Do parrot falcons live in Vermont?
They sure do. They've had a wonderful recovery in Vermont. Where are the nearest ones nesting? Do you know?
Barely.
I think there's some up. I don't remember where. I'm not going to try and guess. But they're doing well in Vermont, and researchers know where they're all nesting. We had a pair of peregrine falcons that one year thought they might like to nest in the old quarry, but the ravens disabused them of that thought.
Yeah. If you go to the Vermont State Department of Natural Resources site and search on peregrine cliff closures, it'll list all of the cliffs that they don't want pikers or rock climbers on because of there's a nest. And you can actually find a clip of a rock climber being buzzed by a peregrine. But another note, it's interesting with the Cooper's Hawk and the Merlin, they also like another kind of hunting in which they fly low to the ground, and if anything pops up underneath them, they are, so it's sort of active flying, and then something flushes in the air, and
that's how the Merlins hunt along the seashore for shorebirds. They will go low, and I've watched them do that. And those things will go up, and if they're adept, they can pick out the one that's a little bit slower or weaker or whatever. And I can remember one time we were doing a Christmas count, and we were someplace here in Dummerston, and we saw this shark shin come in low, went up over a barn and down to the feeders just like that. I mean, it was like a fighter attack and an ambush. It was really, I don't remember whether it was successful or not. Yeah.
What causes a group of birds to harass a bigger bird?
Well, it doesn't necessarily have to be a bigger bird, but usually that's a case of they perceive it as some sort of a threat. So crows will get harassed, blue jays will get harassed, hawks and owls will get harassed, because they are in some way perceived as a threat. I can remember one year, a few years ago, on Route 30, right by the retreat meadows, there was a barred owl in the tree. This was during the daytime. And I got out to look at it, and there was a downy woodpecker that kept its distance but was making a lot of noise. It wasn't long before there were a whole bunch of other birds that came in. It's called mobbing. And the other birds were bigger ones. It was as though the downy sent out the call for
protection.
The troopers. Well, I don't know that the owl posed any particular threat, but when you get something like that, you don't take a chance. So you'll often see crows harassing red tails along the highways. And a friend of mine says that if you see crows mobbing around the top of a tall tree, it's probably because there's a great horned owl there. Well, it may or may not be, but they sure don't like great horned owls, for good reason.
Yeah. You mentioned one hawk that didn't go all the way south, that survived in the winter by catching...
The red tails... Red tails migrate, but they don't go as far south as, what most of the birds are doing is they're following their food.
Yeah.
As the song, like the accipiters, the sharp-shinned and the coopers, the song, they rely on songbirds. The songbirds go south, they follow the food. Mm-hmm. Some of them will stay around because we have lots of pigeons in town and we have lots of bird feeders around, so a few can survive up here, but most of them go south.
So it's not species-wide, it's just a couple of people figure out that they can hang out and survive.
Yeah, and there's a peregrine, peregrine falcons go a long way. Mm-hmm. Some of them go to southern South America. But there is a peregrine falcon that hangs out in the town hall of Gloucester, Mass. And I've never been over there in the wintertime on a birding trip where I haven't seen this guy, either perched in the tower or chasing after the pigeons or doing something. You know, he spends the winter.
He's comfy.
Yeah.
Yeah. We saw about a week ago a bald eagle at the retreat meadows, and then somebody saw it again, so we were wondering if there was a nest around there.
I think that may be happening sometime. I don't know that there's a nest there, but there have been eagles hanging out there off and on. And a couple of years ago, somebody saw a young eagle picking up sticks. And that's an indication of nesting, but I don't think anything came up.
You have mentioned in your talk the gosling, I think, hawk that stuck around.
Goshawk.
Or goshawk.
G-O-S.
Goshawk.
Yeah.
That's stuck around in the area.
Yeah. They really are a forest and higher elevation bird, and some of them migrate. I mean, we have some that we see. And we have lots of discussions about when we see goshawks as to whether or not they're migrating or not. But they're, depending on the population of the grouse and snowshoe hares, they can make a living in the Green Mountains, where winter is pretty tough. Yes?
Can you identify a species by the height that it cruises at?
No. No. That varies a great deal on when we're on the mountain counting hawks on weather conditions. They're good thermals. They may get up real high. What was it? Sunday, John, you said all the birds strained your eyes. Yesterday they were fairly low. Sometimes they're right at treetop levels. It depends more on weather conditions. Yeah. Yes?
I just wonder if you or anyone else here knows. I remember a guy in Connecticut used to bring an Andean condor named Vidor to Bonnyvale.
Uh-huh.
And I just wondered what happened to Vidor, if he's still around. I did a web search and found nothing.
I have no idea.
Okay.
Yeah.
What are the ideal conditions to go to a mountain to see him? If we wanted to pick a good day, what conditions would we look for?
Well, I'll tell you this, but there are exceptions, okay? Many of them. Generally speaking, if a cold front has come through that clears things out and gives a wind out of the northwest, that's a good day. In looking at the weather for the next few days, John and I think Saturday might be a good day. Kind of crummy weather right now. You know, nothing was going today. But I can remember, one of our watchers said that September the 16th, if you come up, he guarantees you'll see at least 500 birds. unless it's actually raining that day. And, you know, he looked at the counts from several years to say that. I think last year he got skunked, and last year was our best year. A couple years ago, we got up there, and it was a miserable gray day, and the wind was out of the east, and there wasn't anything. 9, 10, all of a sudden at 11 o'clock they started flying, and in the next hour we had something like 1,500 birds. They just had to go. But it was a day that nobody would have said would have been a good day. And that particular year, I think it was the best day.
What do you mean they had to go?
Well, they had to go south. It was time to go. Sooner or later, they've got to go. The broadwings can go almost all day without flapping because they ride the rising heat thermals, get to the top of them, cruise on to the next one, rise up, cruise on. They don't have to flap a lot.
Is there any money in this?
Not a second. Some of the big watch sites, like Cape May or Hawk Mountain, they hire low-cost interns. You know, the people who need something on their resume. It's worthwhile. It's worthwhile to them. But no, there's no money.
I was in the New Mexico mountains with an organization called Hawk Watch, and I made $15 a day with a BS in wildlife management.
Yeah. Yep.
And I sold plasma on the weekends.
I believe it. Yeah.
Where do you submit your data? How is it archived, and who then uses it?
John more or less collects the numbers. It's reported to the North American Hawk Watch Association, and they have those numbers from all of the hawk watches across the nation, and you can go on that site and see what is happening on Putney Mountain as well as comparing what's happening now with what has happened on similar days. But that's where it goes, and then the number crunchers take it from there and analyze it. And we see some, you know, the Hawk Watch, it's not scientifically accurate, but it reveals macro trends.
What was that site again?
What's that?
What was the site again that gets reported?
North American Hawk Watch Association. NAHWA. Get that right? I think so.
You can also
know
the Humana Association of North America. They have a website.
You can Google something like that and find it. I'm sorry, I don't remember it exactly. Yes?
What's the rough total of birds they're cutting out of the whole season?
The average would be 4,500, John, in a typical year. Last year we almost reached 10. We don't expect that to happen. And of those, on average, about 60% are broadwings and fly in the middle of September.
What the reason is for the large numbers last year?
Best guess is all of those pictures I had of rodents. There was lots of food, so lots of nesting success. And probably a lot of those didn't make it. But last year, about this time, I said to somebody, there are going to be a lot of daytime sightings of barred owls in the wintertime, 12, 13 winter. And there were. And I said that on the basis of all of the rodents that were around. And what happens is, in the wintertime for the barred owls, the youngsters in particular don't know how to deal with it and can't hunt and don't survive or end up in a rehab center. That's our best guess, because I don't think there was anything unusual about weather patterns that would have brought the birds over us. Yeah.
Global warming, has that are the birds flying later in the season than before, let's say 20 or 30 years ago?
No. They seem to be going about the same time.
Same time. So.
And that has to do really with what's happening with their food sources. And the migratory songbirds are probably going more on daylight and sun than they are on climate. At least that's my best guess. Thank you very much.